Have you ever felt the presence of some unnatural forces when you used exceptions to manage domain errors? You felt it right. There has always been something strange about exceptions in languages such as C#, Java, and similar. I will now show you what that is. Straight to the point, we can assume the existence of some method that receives an argument and returns a result. It would use another method as a dependency. You can ignore the operations completely. It doesn't matter what these methods are doing. Just think about the relationship between the calling method and its dependency. And then comes the twist. What will happen if the dependency has a dependency? The third method would calculate some value from the argument, and the intermediate method would depend on that calculation. I'm imagining that method A is taking the result of method B and adding 2 to it. Method B uses method C to obtain some modular value and then returns the modular result. Method C is using its own means to calculate the modular value. The critical concept to understand is that each method has its own responsibility, which it encapsulates. The methods then form a chain of dependencies. Then comes the error propagation, which I will implement via exceptions. For example, method B might throw an exception that indicates that request was invalid. There could also be some imaginary arithmetic overflow. These are legitimate errors in the domain of method B. I will simulate the cases where it occasionally throws one exception or the other. This is the point where you might start feeling strange. So let me explain what is strange here. Method B has now acquired the second channel to communicate its result. One channel was the return value. The other is for throwing an exception. However, these two kinds of results are received in substantially different ways. It is time to raise the bar and think of how exception propagation works under the hood. The working principle of exceptions resembles dynamic scoping. Dynamic scoping is about variables. It doesn't exist in languages like C#, Java, and similar, where all variables are statically scoped. I will declare a variable in the calling method and use it here. However, when method A calls method B, that variable becomes inaccessible to the method B. It is defined within the stack frame of the method A execution. Still, I would like to imagine a language in which you can modify that variable even though it only exists within the executing method that invoked this method. Even more, could you imagine jumping over your immediate caller and accessing or modifying a variable declared 2 methods above on the call stack? That is how languages with dynamic scoping work. C# and many other languages we use on a regular basis are not of that kind. I must comment these lines out because they don't compile in C#. But then I will remind you that this is precisely how exceptions work in this programming language. So again, let me return to the beginning of this video. If you ever felt there is something strange about exceptions in C#, then that is because there really is something strange about exceptions in C#. They behave similarly to how dynamically scoped languages work, where this programming language is not dynamically scoped. Now I must catch an exception in the calling context. I must react to every possible exception that might arrive, or they would keep bubbling up the call stack, eventually crashing the application. That includes catching all other exceptions at the topmost point in the application, so to prevent crashing due to an unhandled exception. These exceptions still observe all other principles of object-oriented programming. For example, you can create a base exception. The object substitution rule would be in effect. You can catch the base exception and handle all variants of that exception type in one catch block if you like. But then that dynamic nature of exception propagation rears its head again. In the same way component B defines the set of errors characteristic for its own domain, component C does within its separate domain. That could be some I/O error, network error, timeout error, for example. That is the language method C is speaking. By the way, that is precisely the language method A is not speaking. Each method and each component in the system operates at its own level of abstractness. I will now pretend that these errors happen randomly during the method's execution. Then happens the strangest thing you can imagine. Method B is not catching any of these exceptions. It is oblivious to their existence. That is that dynamic scoping nature of exceptions coming to the picture again. The exceptions will jump over the stack frames and only stop at a place where they encounter an appropriate catch block. The exception will pop up in a method that doesn't have an explicit dependency on it. My point here is that the dependency of the dependency has now leaked into the topmost method by jumping over the stack frames and ending up at this place. Method A doesn't know that method C even exists. Change method C and you might break method A, which doesn't even know method C exists. I will now show you one practical application of all I have said in the minimal API project I also have here. You can download this entire source code from my Patreon page. Please note that this channel is free only thanks to the patrons. Every registered patron is helping hundreds of other fellow programmers watch more than 100 videos on my channel for free. Now, this extension method parses the input string received from the HTTP request into a culture info object. It does not use exceptions because of the problem I have outlined in this video. The method utilizes the getCultureInfo static method. The second argument indicates that the call should throw if the culture name is not one of the known culture names. However, this method will stop the propagation of that exception by turning it into a failure result. You can learn about the result pattern from my earlier videos. There is a list of videos you should watch in the description. In this video, I want to consider the possibility of letting that exception bubble up. This is the corresponding implementation of the same extension that returns the result on those two tracks. One is statically scoped. The return value. That one is only valid if nothing goes wrong during the method's execution. The other track is the dynamically scoped one. It would propagate the exception up the calling stack. The problem with this exception is that we cannot tell who will handle it and whether anyone will handle it. Only the immediate caller knows for sure the meaning of the culture name argument. Its immediate caller might already be confused by the appearance of some culture name exception. We cannot tell that the exception will fall into the right hands. For that reason, in this minimal API project, I didn't let the culture info exception bubble up. I captured it into the result type instead. You can read the source code of this minimal API and check how I used the result type to contain exceptions.